Thank you very much, Permanent Secretary. I'd like to ask Minister Evarist to address the conference.
Good morning. Nice to welcome you from all corners of the globe, I've been told. So I usually hate long speeches because you can go on and on, but the most important thing is to have people listening to you, not just talking on your own. So I'll try to share some of my experiences and reflections with you and hope that it will contribute to what you will be discussing in this conference. We're calling the conference the State of Digital Education. I usually hate adjectives with education. We talk either about good education or poor education. We tend to talk about digital education, academic education, vocational education. It's either good education or poor education. And I think that there are characteristics of what makes education a good experience. And personally, I think that one of the best ever documents, very underrated, that has been written about education in the last 20 years, and I think it's still relevant today. My colleagues have heard me talk about this over and over again, so I apologize for mentioning things which I keep on telling them, is the task force that the UNESCO had set up around 20 years ago, chaired by Jacques Delors, and the report was The Treasure Within Education for the 21st Century. I think it's still a very relevant document, whatever kind of education we are discussing, what we're talking about. And there, the conclusions were very, very simple. That the most important things about education is learning to know, learning to do, learning to be, learning to live together. I think in those few words, I think it's a very powerful message. Recently, OECD came out with a document which endorses, I think, this approach, but obviously as it's OECD, it has to be technocratic. So the title is called 4D Education, 4-dimensional education, and it talks about knowledge, about skills, about character. It's good to have OECD discovering the importance of character and moral development of people as well. So the world has not totally gone mad. So that's good. And then the most important thing is meta-learning, learning to learn. And I think that is, if there is one purpose in education today, is learning to learn. Because that is something which we're going to need in every area. I think we still have a long way to go. I think most of the school systems in the world, in Europe and in the world, and if not totally, but definitely dominant aspects of the schooling system, is still the one which I would call the military model. Some people might think that I'm exaggerating, but I'll try to explain. We must remember that the idea of general schooling and universal schooling was started by Bismarck, not to develop 21st century skills. Mainly the idea was to open schools for boys and young men to prepare them to die patriotically on the battlefield. Basically the motto of education at that time was the charge of the Light Brigade. There's not to question why, there's but to do and die. Now to leap from that kind of model to what we call 21st century skills, critical thinking, creativity, problem solving, working together, is a long way to go, because I think in dominant aspects of curricula, pedagogy, and assessment, it is still standardization that rules. It's still, I think, the military model, obviously modified over the last 200 years, but we're still there. Obviously, for logistical purpose, it's a very convenient model, because we make people fit into a framework, into a system, into a structure. If they don't fit, the problem is not the structure or the system, they are the problem. And we have an expression in Maltese which probably has its equivalence in other languages, which is that we have kids that are not good for school, whereas in fact it's schools that are not good for kids. And I think we must, if we really want to talk about having education which is relevant today and which is going to be relevant tomorrow, we need to keep on moving away from this model, to move away from standardization, and as much as possible move towards personalization. It's obviously more complicated, it's obviously more difficult, but I'm sure that if there's any one area where, you know, digital technology will make a difference, is exactly in this area, that it is making it possible now to move away from standardization of education towards personalization. I don't know how many of you remember 40 years ago, the rage in education was Ivan Illich, the schooling society. Those of you who are not familiar with Ivan Illich, I suggest revisiting his book, The Schooling Society, because he was proposing the schooling society. I think now it's happening but it's happening in a way where we have to manage. Because what do I mean by this? Unless we make education relevant, unless we make educational experience relevant, and it's so easy for it to be obsolete and so easy for it to be meaningless. And I mean, children can come to school, students can come to school, they can attend, they can be there, present a cadavere, but is education taking place? Although we call the place a school, although we call it a learning institution. Obviously for us it's not important just to attend schools, although there are millions of kids who are still deprived of attending schools. But for us, what is important is that they come to school and that the experience is rich, it's developing their potential, they are learning. Now, how do we test that? How do we know that they're learning? And the challenge that we have is that we tend to live in parallel worlds, that we test children according to what they learn formally in school, but then we need to ask the uncomfortable, very uncomfortable question, is what they are learning in school, the way we test their knowledge or their skills or the information that they have memorized, is that the way to prepare them for the real world? Okay, I mean, at least schools perhaps help us to get the children to sit properly in a bath when they're taking a bath, but it's definitely not preparing them to swim in rough seas. And that is what we need to do. We need to teach them, to help develop in them the ability to swim in the rough seas of the 21st century. Because after all, that is the real test, you know. And I think we need to get education as much as possible to be experienced and developed in a way as if reality matters. And I will keep on repeating this, that we need to contaminate education with as much reality as possible. in the same way that we need to contaminate reality with as much education as possible. So it works. It works two way. And in my case, I live this practically every day because I happen to be, I think, as far as I know, the only in the world. So there is a first. The only minister who is responsible for education and employment at the same time. Now, I'm a bit of a masochist. I mean, to be in politics, you must have strong masochistic tendencies. And to be minister for education is already tough. To be minister for education and employment is already more tough. But I think, ideally, this ministry should have three responsibilities, which is Minister for Education, Ministry for Employment, and Ministry for Civil Rights. Because I think that these three go together. It's education, civil rights, employability. For a long time, unfortunately, even the European Union forgot citizenship and forgot civil rights when we discussed education. Unfortunately, it was only after the Charles Hebdo terrible incidents in Paris that we remembered that we must also have education relevant for citizenship and for civil rights and for navigating in the uncharted and difficult waters of the 21st century in our society. That was a rude awakening. Now it's back on the agenda. And we must make sure that whether whatever education we're discussing, whether digital, non-digital, vocational, academic, applied, these, I think, three important areas need to be brought together. It's education, yes, but it's society, civil society, and employability and the economy. And I think that learning for life and learning for employability, learning for, you know, not for a specific job, but learning for employability, go together. They're not in contradiction with each other, because the skills that we are expecting and the values that we are expecting of our people at the workplace, and I suggest that we don't talk only about skills, but we also talk about values, because I think some of the biggest problems that we've had in the last few years haven't been problems of technical knowledge. You're like, was the financial crisis only an economic crisis, or was it also an ethical crisis? The problem with diesel emissions and Volkswagen, was that an engineering problem, or was it an ethical problem? You know, the engineers got their stuff very right. In fact, even the emission apparatus that they created was very good engineering-wise. But ethically, and I think the same for financial services. In financial services, we had the best minds. Unfortunately, in fact, what was happening, and to a certain extent it's still happening, that the best minds in a lot of different areas, ranging from literature to engineering, mathematics, science, the best minds were going to the financial services sector to invent programs and design schemes on how to cheat citizens. Perhaps it's not the politically correct way to say it, but basically that is what was happening. And then the system collapsed and citizens had to pay the price as well. So I really believe that just talking about skills and just talking about technical competence and education is not enough. And I repeat that it is possible. It is possible to move away from what we're doing, and it is possible to do this only if we are ready to bring together what happens in schools, what happens in education institutions, with what happens outside these education institutions. Education alone, cannot face these formidable challenges that we have. We have to align together education and social and economic policies. Even we just say, you know, if we talk about the 22 million people who live in poverty or social exclusion in the European Union and their children, what can formal education do for them if at the same time we're not addressing the issues of poverty and social exclusion? And you can't do that simply through education. You have to make sure that your social and economic policies there are reinforcing and supporting what's happening in education. And this is where we must move away from the politics of austerity and go for the politics of investment and growth. Because otherwise, we're simply making it easier, apart from the fact that there's a lot of human suffering going on. We're making it easier for those who will say, oh, you know, the problems are huge, digital skills are your enemies because digitalization and globalization is leaving you behind, your economies are dying, your jobs, you're losing your jobs, but, you know, nothing is taking your place because of dislocation, because you don't have the skills to take the new jobs that are being created, if any new jobs are being created. And so the growth of populism is because of that. It's quite easy to bash populism and, you know, attack the different politicians. As a minister of government, I'm not supposed to mention heads of state or people who are soon to be heads of state. Guess who I'm referring to? We need to look at the causes. You know, looking at what happens in France, in Italy, in Holland, in the United States, in Germany, we need to look at the causes. What happened in the UK with Brexit? The problem is not Brexit. The problem is what were the political and social conditions that created Brexit. I've spoken to people who voted to leave, and it's so easy to say, oh, they haven't been to university, they're stupid, they're not sophisticated people, they don't live in London, they used to work in the mines. Ah, yes, of course, they used to work in the mines, they used to work in the steel industry. If those economies have died and nothing has taken their place, also for them, not just for others, because I've been to societies where the old economy has died and the new economy is being created, but it's not for the people who lost their jobs. And who are we to blame them for feeling that they've lost out? So this issue of the digital education has to be lifelong. It's not, and I do believe that it's not a matter of, you know, automation is going to gather speed and is going to be very strong. But it's not going, I don't think we should see it as men and women, obviously, and machines or machines. It's, we have to see how robotics and the new economy that is already being created. We mustn't simply say, ah, good, on this assembly line we used to have 20 people. Now we've automated it and we have 5. And we're very happy that we have 5 and those are very highly skilled. But what has happened to the other 15? We have a right to ask that and see how education, lifelong education, can help face these challenges. If we do not, if we live in our bubble and simply cater for people who are highly skilled, who are prepared to live in this digital world, and forget all those who are being left behind, we're going to pay the price, because reality will catch up with us, and it has caught up with us in a number of societies, and it will continue to do so. So it's important that we take this in consideration when we plan our changes. We're talking about changes all the time in this document that has been presented. Yes, we need to change. We need to take the people with us, teachers, parents. It's very important that we mobilize all the people involved. We simply can't rush, you know, to make it happen. We have to work with our teachers. We have to work with our kids, parents. Change is necessary, and it will take time. And I think we need also to have the courage to say this. some of the developments that at least are happening. I think we need to make them happen in education as well. It's good to find out that in even when it comes to food, we're going back to at least slow cooking, the joy of slow cooking and slow thinking, because we are, you know, simply rushing through things. We need to slow down. I think even in education, we need to slow down, but at the same time, then make the necessary steps. Slowing down and thinking deeply about the issues that we need to address and building alternatives and making the next steps are not in contradiction with each other. Simply rushing, and, you know. Anyway, we have quite a lot to do. I think, and probably I have already spoken too much, no? So, anyway, that's enough. So I'm looking forward to the conclusions of this conference. Please come up with the solutions. If you don't, I have you to blame, okay? I'm asking you to solve all our problems. If you don't solve our problems, we won't allow you to leave the island. I hope that you get a chance to look around and be beyond the walls of this hotel. Thank you very much for being here, and I really look forward to the conclusions of this conference. Thank you.